Good morning. We start with terrible breaking news. South Australia police are investigating the tragic death of a 13-year-old boy who was killed when the industrial bin he was sleeping in was emptied at Port Lincoln. Investigators say three boys, aged 11, 12 and 13, were sleeping in the bin when it was picked up around 5:20 this morning. One of the boys managed to jump out, while the other one wasn't hurt, but sadly the eldest suffered fatal injuries. Police say the truck driver was unaware the children were inside and has been left terribly shaken. We'll take you to our reporter for more details coming up shortly. Well, the Treasurer is just hours away from handing down his third federal budget, but it's been an unusual start to the day. Political reporter Eliza Edwards joins us live from Canberra. Eliza, good morning. What happened?
Well, good morning, Davina. It's the biggest day on the parliamentary calendar here, but some politicians took longer than usual to get to work this morning as a protest held up their commute. Extinction Rebellion activists blocking the entrance of the Commonwealth car depot, and one person was arrested there. That's all wrapped up now. So MPs and senators are here for a busy budget day. Tonight, the Treasurer will announce big spending pledges for aged care, childcare, mental health and infrastructure. Josh Frydenberg will also reveal exactly how Australia's economic rebound is tracking, with the budget expected to be tens of billions of dollars better off than what was forecast a few months ago.
Australia's strong position today is not the result of luck. Australia makes its own luck. And tonight's budget will lay out the Morrison government's economic plan to secure Australia's recovery.
Davina, the Treasurer is putting women at the centre of the budget after a difficult 3 months for the government, accused of mishandling a series of issues around the culture of this building and the treatment of women.
Everything in this budget is about the government trying to solve a political problem of its own making.
And in the category of budget day stunts, crossbench MP Craig Kelly tried to make a point of debt closing in on $1 trillion by printing a stack of fake money. Davina?
OK, Eliza, thank you. Well, the second senior Victorian public servant responsible for infection control in the state's troubled hotel quarantine system has stepped aside. It comes after General Manager Matu Bush was stood down last week after allegations he breached protocols on two separate occasions. The state government insists the alleged breaches were low risk and have not disclosed the costs of replacements. Well, Richmond is this morning standing by two of its stars who were involved in a nightclub scuffle over the weekend. We'll go live to Alicia Mewling, who broke this story. Alicia, good morning to you. What's the club had to say?
Well, Davina, Richmond is confident that both Shay Bolton and Daniel Rioli are being honest with them when it comes to exactly what happened inside a Melbourne nightclub on Saturday night. Now, the players say that Daniel Rioli's girlfriend was harassed while she was standing at the bar. She was verbally abused and inappropriately touched. And when Rioli went to confront the man involved, he was punched in the face. That's when Shay Bolton got involved and he injured his wrist in an altercation. Now, we saw Daniel Rioli this morning. He was out training on Punt Road Oval, sporting a black eye and some significant bruising to the right side of his face. As for Shay Bolton, he comes off a lot more worse for wear. He's in for surgery on a fractured wrist and he'll miss 2 or 3 weeks of football. Now, the CEO of the Richmond Footy Club, Brendan Gale, addressed the media a short time ago. The club, as you say, certainly backing its players, but there are still a number of unanswered questions.
Brendan, how did Shay actually break his wrist?
In the altercation.
So did he throw a punch?
Look, I'm not sure. I mean, in the general altercation, the steps that were taken, I'm not sure.
Are the police involved or is this going to be a police matter?
I'm not sure at this stage. I mean, that'll be a matter for the players. I'm not sure. I don't think so.
Now, the AFL is working with the Richmond Football Club to obtain some CCTV from inside the Melbourne nightclub. But at this stage, neither Bolton nor Rioli will be reprimanded by the club, Davina.
Big loss for the fans, though. OK, Alicia, thank you. Well, a key Victorian crossbench MP hopes to create 3 new safe injecting rooms in areas of Melbourne with high-level drug use. Fiona Patton put forward a proposal for centres to be set up in St Kilda, Footscray and Dandenong, but the government isn't supporting the extra locations.
What we will do is respond to the independent review, which was one further site within Melbourne CBD.
The new centres would also have the capacity to carry out pill testing. Well, the East Coast is on wild weather watch this morning. Southeast Queensland already copping a dangerous lightning storm overnight, leaving thousands without power. Peter Fegan has the latest.
Well, they rolled through this morning while most of us would have been asleep. But if you were one of the lucky ones that was up and about after 1 a.m. this morning, then you were certainly treated to quite a spectacular light show brought to you by Mother Nature. The early morning storms produced some 66,000 lightning strikes across Brisbane and the southeast. As you can see now by these incredible pictures that we're showing you, it was certainly quite unique, even seen as far as Dalby. But with the lightning, there was strong winds and heavy rain, with some suburbs in Brisbane and the southeast recording 20 millimetres in under 20 minutes. Energex has said up to 17,500 homes and businesses were without power, although throughout the morning many had since been restored. The Bureau of Meteorology is predicting the rain activity across southeast Queensland will increase this week, especially today and tomorrow. Rainfall is expected to be heaviest across the Sunshine Coast and Gold Coast regions today, with up to 30 millimetres expected to fall.
In the United States, children as young as 12 will be able to get the Pfizer vaccine after being given the green light by health regulators. The Federal Vaccine Advisory Committee will meet tomorrow to discuss how the shots will be safely rolled out amongst 12 to 15-year-olds. It's hoped they'll be able to get the vaccine before they head back to school in the coming weeks. And there is good news for residents in England. They'll be allowed to hug loved ones and enjoy some indoor activities as social restrictions ease. Our UK correspondent Ben Avery explains.
Well, these are significant changes that will come into effect from next Monday, May 17. So pubs, restaurants and cafes will be allowed to welcome back customers indoors. Things like museums, indoor play areas and cinemas will be allowed to reopen. And people will once again be allowed to go on international holidays, something they haven't been able to do so far this year.
This unlocking amounts to a very considerable step on the road back to normality. And I am confident that we will be able to go further.
Now, Boris Johnson has also announced that for the first time in more than 12 months, hugging will be again allowed, albeit people need to do it cautiously.
Whoever I hug, I can assure you it will be done with caution and restraint. I'm not going to you know, act it out now, but I think we all know what we mean.
Now, the Prime Minister has also announced some other good news today, and that is that the COVID-19 situation here in the UK is improving dramatically. Deaths and hospitalisations from the virus are now at their lowest levels since July of last year.
Hundreds of surfers who set a world record with a paddle out to stop a controversial development south of Wollongong are having their calls heard. Among 700 surfers who took to the water at Killarlea State Park, calling for the state government to scrap plans to build luxury eco-cabins at the site. Cabinet Minister Gareth Ward is backing the group, labelling the consultation process abysmal and wants National Parks and Wildlife Services to protect the site. Well, the Australian share market has plunged more than 55 points at the opening of trade, despite closing a record high yesterday. The huge gains have helped the market recoup losses suffered on the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic in March last year.